State Court come to order. May she be seated.
Thank you for your patience and sorry for the delay. We ran way longer than we anticipated this morning. Okay, well, first, Brendan, go right ahead.
Your Honor, on your chair, Jason Lamonaco for defendant. On your chair was a two-page document that I put there and a one-page that I put there for Ms. Neill.
Okay,
the one-page document, it basically kind of an order, I think, that we're going to take the motions in today with one change. It has defendant's motion to dismiss, defendant's motion, which I'm arguing, defendant's motion for summary judgment, which Mr. Lipschutz is arguing, it's on the counterclaims. Then insert from number two into number one, defendant's motion to strike plaintiff's affidavit, because that was regarding the summary judgment motion.
Okay.
And then plaintiff's motion to add claims, and plaintiff's motion for summary judgment. So what I think I'm gonna do is, I will argue my motion to dismiss. I will comment, just very briefly, I will, on the other motions, let Mr. Lipschutz argue, let Ms. Neill then argue, and then we'll move on to number two, which Ms. Neill will be going back and forth on those.
Okay.
The second document in front of you is my outline of the first page is what remaining causes of action are in this case after plaintiff has amended and has withdrawn some of her claims. And then the second page is the pending motions, just a list of the pending motions.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you.
Okay. Again, my name is Jason Lamonaco. I represent Defendant Mount Vernon Towers Condominium Association, Inc. I'm in the condominium industry, and we just kind of get into the habit of saying the association, whereas Ms. Neill is a unit owner of a condominium.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The audience cannot hear.
I'll go to the microphones. So occasionally my system will make a bad noise when it's not loud enough. So I'll do this or when it's too loud, I'm sorry.
Oh, there we go.
Thank you.
Does that help?
Yes, thank you.
Work for everybody?
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you.
And how's this? Does it work on mine?
No, I don't hear yours.
All right. How's that?
Good.
Okay, make sure I'm still here too. Okay.
Go right ahead.
Okay. This is a lawsuit that was initiated by Ms. Neill, a unit owner in Mount Vernon Towers, against the Condominium Association. What I did not put on my list that I just jotted notes down, originally, the causes of action this is a declaratory judgment action, you know, through and through. So Ms. Neill wanted a declaratory judgment that the association must disclose a certain pension contract with a former employee who is receiving a pension from the association. This is Mr. Miller, you may hear referred to at some point. So one of the claims was that declaratory judgment that the association is obligated to disclose Mr. Miller's pension contract, a declaratory judgment that the association must disclose the amount of the pension, and declaratory judgment that the association must calculate and then disclose the present value of the life of the pension. In addition to that, those three claims, based on what I have here, are no longer pending. What is pending is her original claim. Part of original claims was a declaratory judgment that a certain $5,000 special assessment levied by the association against her be declared invalid, void, unenforceable, whatever, not collectible. And then a claim for 13611 attorney's fees. Based upon some emails between myself and Ms. Neill, which I attached to my last opposition brief in opposition to her motion to, for leave to amend and put in one more claim, which is one of the motions being argued today. I attached an email chain, and then in her final reply, which is basically the last brief in this case, she quoted someone I said, and I think basically agrees with me at this point, that the pending claims are one, declaratory judgment, that the $5,000 special assessment is invalid, void, whatever. She amended at one point to include a OCGA 1061 claim that the association is responsible for all acts of its attorneys. And of course, all along, she has had a claim for 13611 attorney's fees. I included the 1061 claim that the association is responsible for acts of its attorney's fees. That's really not a cause of action. That's just an argument in favor of a cause of action that I win on the, you know, either 13611 or I win on the special assessment issue because of the acts of the association's responsible for the acts of its agents and attorneys. It's just, it's an argument in favor of a cause of action. It's not a cause of action itself. But I include it in there because I believe Ms. Neill disagrees with that. She does have two pending motions pursuant to 915.14 for attorney's fees. And then a pending motion for permission to amend the complaint to add a cause of action that the $5,000 special assessment was an ultra vires act. That's not a cause of action either. That's just another argument in favor that, you know, it's ultra vires, in favor of her existing cause of action for declaratory judgment that the $5,000 special assessment is wrong, invalid, incorrect, for whatever reason. You have any, you know, she has the claim for declaratory judgment. This special assessment's no good. She can have any number of reasons why. Ultra vires, wasn't authorized, wasn't properly voted on, the condo act might prohibit it, whatever reasons. This new claim that it's an ultra vires act is just another one of those arguments in favor of the existing claim. So I don't think there's any reason to add a new claim just specifically saying it's ultra vires. It's already here. She can argue that, and she has been, I think, all along. Okay. So, three claims. Declaratory judgment, $5,000 special assessment is invalid. This 1061 claim, which I think is really not a cause of action, and 13611 attorney's fees. While there were still additional claims that have since been withdrawn, Mount Vernon Towers Condominium Association, we moved to dismiss. Two main reasons. One, this is not a proper the special assessment issue is not a proper subject for declaratory judgment. And then two, on the claims that are no longer here, that they were really derivative claims, you know, that an individual member of a corporation doesn't have the right to bring. It's the corporation itself that might have the right to bring derivative claims. But since none of those, that would have dealt with, that we're obligated to disclose it to the entire membership that this contract would tell. Well, that's not. She pled it two ways. One, disclose it to me. Two, disclose it to everyone. To disclose it to everyone isn't her claim. That's everybody's claim. That's everyone has in common. So we say that that's really the corporation's claim. She doesn't have standing to do it. Then that the amount of the pension, disclose that to everybody. Same thing. Calculate and disclose the present value of the pension. Again, the same thing. That's not an individual member's claim. Whether the association calculated it properly or calculated it at all, one unit owner doesn't have some special right to get that information. That's something, obviously, that's for the good of everyone. Since those claims aren't here, the derivative section of my motion probably, you know, really doesn't apply anymore. What does apply is the lack of subject matter jurisdiction. Declaratory judgment, and I'm not going to go too much in depth in this, I briefed it initially and then in reply. Declaratory judgment, and I cited a perfect case that's, you know, analogous to this, is not a proper form of an action to declare the correctness or incorrectness of an act that has already occurred. This special assessment was levied on her in the fall of 2018 before she brought this case. She brought an action in, I guess it was the beginning of 19, okay, so the beginning of this year, saying, hey, that special assessment is wrong, declare it wrong for any number of reasons. The court lacks subject matter jurisdiction because that event already occurred. Cited in my brief, it's Crittenton versus Southland Owners Association,
since I didn't know the briefs, talked about a homeowners association election that had occurred. And they said, wait a second, there was all this fraud. This election was improper. Declaratory judgment. The court said, no, you're trying to get the court to determine the correctness or incorrectness of a past event. That's not the proper subject matter for a declaratory judgment. So that is the argument on that. I think one of the counter arguments, oh, the court doesn't have equitable power. This is not an equity case. She didn't seek an injunction, you know, enjoin us from trying to collect it. The court would have subject matter jurisdiction for that. She sought a very particular form of action, declaratory judgment, for which the court doesn't have subject matter. In addition, and more in my reply brief, I touched on it in my original motion, but drilled down a little further in my reply brief on it, declaratory judgment is not a vehicle to determine who's going to win related litigation. What do I mean? The association, through Mr. Lipschutz, has counterclaimed, saying, we want to collect the $5,000 assessment. It is not the proper subject matter of declaratory judgment action to determine who's going to win that claim. It will be the merits of the claim. Is this $5,000 assessment right, wrong, collectible, uncollectible, provable, unprovable, is being fully litigated and will be determined by Your Honor in the context of Mr. Lipschutz's counterclaim to actually collect the $5,000 assessment, and both sides have moved for summary judgment on that. So declaratory judgment is both no jurisdiction and effectively moot at this point, because there is a vehicle where it will be decided. And once Your Honor decides that, it's moot, but I don't think the court had jurisdiction to do declaratory judgment to begin with. I don't want to say any more about that. I briefed it. There's a lot of briefing in this case, so you know what's in there. I'm sure Your Honor is going to be reading them. All right. I think I already mentioned that in the list, Ms. Neill wrote plaintiff's motion to add claims for breach of contract. That's not what the motion asked for. It's motion to add claim that the $5,000 special assessment is ultra-virus. And as I said, that's not a claim. That's just another argument that's already can be made before the court for a declaratory judgment claim. I think the declaratory judgment claim has to go for the reasons I've said. And for that reason, any ultra-virus argument goes with it for all those same reasons. But it's already before the court. We don't have to be amending anything to bring it in here on that. All right. We have all the other motions that I will deal with in turn, but not now. I guess it's Mr. Lipschutz's turn to argue summary judgment on the special assessment. Just to preface what it was about, I'll let Mr. Lipschutz preface what it's about. It's the association's claim. I'm just defense. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. Again, I'm Randy Lipschutz. I represent Mount Vernon Towers Condominium Association on the counterclaim. I'm going to address the summary judgment motion first, and then briefly deal with our motion to strike the affidavit, because the one affidavit that was submitted, if it's stricken, plaintiff has submitted no evidence to the court to counter the affidavits on summary judgment that have been submitted. So I will deal with that as I finish my summary judgment argument.
Okay.
As Jason said, Ms. Neill's an owner and a member of the association. Over the last two or three years, she has been contesting with the board of directors over everything under the sun. She has contested how the dining room was going to be renovated. She's contested how the budget's computed. She's contested eminent domain issues involving the road in front of the association. She has cost the association somewhere in the neighborhood of $30,000 to $40,000 before any assessment was levied against her. That's what they spent dealing with her issues. All of that's documented in Mr. Carrier's affidavit submitted to the court. He's the president of the association. But again, those fees aren't being charged to Ms. Neill. The association decided that as a member, she can argue, she can disagree, she can raise issues, and the association has to deal with that like they would deal with any other member. So they have not charged her that $30,000 or so in costs for all of those other matters. But in this case, Ms. Neill demanded that the association file an insurance claim. She's made a big point of that. She's put that in her affidavit. She's put that in multiple pleadings. She put that in her complaint. The exhibits to the complaint show that Ms. Neill is the one that demanded that the association file an insurance claim. In response to her demand, they did file such a claim. For many months, the carrier had the claim filed, which we filed to make sure that there was no issue of not promptly reporting. But the carrier held off incurring any costs, incurring any charges with insurance appointed counsel to try to see if the matter would disappear, if it would not blossom into this lawsuit or any other lawsuit. So they weren't incurring any fees. They weren't charging her anything. However, at some point in about April, I believe, Ms. Neill drafted a lawsuit and sent the lawsuit and a long proposed brief that she wanted used in the lawsuit to the association for its review, saying she was going to file that case. The insurance carrier was notified of that, and the insurance carrier at that point determined that it had to appoint Mr. LaMonica's firm as defense counsel and began incurring expenses on the insurance claim. Ms. Neill did withdraw her threat to file suit a few days later and instead started demanding that the association file its own suit against Mr. Miller over the pension. That was advised to the insurance carrier and to Mr. LaMonica's office, and the carrier and Ms. LaMonica determined they still needed to continue to deal with the issue because there was still potential litigation threatened that they would have to defend under the claim. So at that point, fees started to be incurred and eventually got to the $5,000 deductible that was subsequently assessed to Ms. Neill. The association in December of last year paid that assessment, or paid that deductible to Mr. LaMonica's firm and assessed Ms. Neill for the $5,000 expense that was caused because she had demanded that an insurance claim be filed and that the case be pursued with the insurance carrier. The original demand is related to the pension paid to Mr. Miller, is being paid to Mr. Miller, the former executive director, but it was approved in 2012. Ms. Neill wasn't even an owner in 2012 when the board of directors approved that pension. The pension was approved upon advice of counsel. The association employed the law firm of McKenna Long Aldridge to draft and advise them on whether they could or how to provide a pension to Mr. Miller. The board made a business decision at the time to grant a pension, and McKenna Long Aldridge drafted it up and had it, and the board approved it, signed the agreement with Mr. Miller, and the pension is being paid. Based upon Ms. Neill's demand in 2017, I think it was, I first got involved as the regular counsel for the association and was asked to review what the board had done in 2012. I looked at it and determined that, in my opinion, the board had corporate authority to give the pension as compensation to an employee, but I said, it's not my area of expertise, and the insurance carrier, which is why McKenna Long Aldridge did the pension in 2012. The carrier had Mr. LaMonica's firm look at it. They came to the same conclusion that McKenna Long Aldridge should come to, that I had come to, that the board had corporate authority. None of us passed on whether or not the pension was wise, good, too much, too little. We just looked at the question of corporate authority, which is all that we had authority to do, because the amount of the pension is a business decision that the board had the authority to make. And everybody that looked at it from the association side confirmed that the board did have authority in 2012 to make that decision. So the $5,000 was assessed against Ms. Neill. The $30,000 of additional fees that had been incurred going through all the other things with Ms. Neill were not assessed because she was an owner. She was entitled to raise issues, and the association absorbed those. But the $5,000 was totally unnecessary. every conclusion, every time somebody looked at that pension, it was determined that the board had corporate authority, had relied on advice of McKenna Long Aldridge's counsel when they entered into it, and that the pension was proper and the association didn't need to file a lawsuit to undo what the prior board had done. Ms. Neill filed suit in January of 2019, again, as Mr. Lamonto said, asking for a copy of the pension and seeking to void the special assessment. We filed our counterclaim because at that point it was a compulsory counterclaim. She had raised the issue of the special assessment. We either had to file a counterclaim to collect it, or it would have been waived as a compulsory counterclaim in any future case, so the counterclaim was filed. We filed our motion for partial summary judgment on the assessment and on liability for attorney's fees. Under the Condominium Act, we supported the claim with affidavits from Mr. Carrier, who is the president of the board, from Chris Peterson, who is the executive director of the association, and then Ms. Neill filed her motion for summary judgment on really exactly one issue, and that is that she is exempt from being able to be assessed under the City Heights Condominium Association versus Bombara case. Under the Condominium Act and under the declaration, the association is permitted to file or to specially assess against an owner that causes an extraordinary expense by their own actions. That's what this association did. The law on that issue is fairly clear. It's been briefed to the court. Ms. Neill hasn't contested any of that in any of her briefs or any of her motions, other than on the Bombara issue. The cases are resplendent, and I'll go one way. The association has the authority to assess, generally, and if the association's entitled to assess, it's entitled to collect its attorney's fees incurred in collecting the assessment. Cases go back to Wehunt versus Renz Cross, La Hacienda Condominium Association, and a number of others that are cited in the briefs. I'm not going to go into all of those. The court has those. The only issue left, other than the liability for attorney's fees, is the amount of attorney's fees, because we realized this case was likely to be ongoing for a while. We did not apply for an amount. That's to be determined at another time by this court if the court decides the assessment's proper and we're entitled to attorney's fees. So we're not dealing with amount at this point. So I don't want to really waste any more time on what on things that have already been briefed. I want to look at the defenses that Ms. Neill has raised to the special assessment. Number one, she has filed volumes, look at the stack on the table, volumes of really unsubstantiated, unsupported, and intentionally false allegations about the association's attorneys, alleging that they've committed fraud, alleging that they've committed malpractice, claiming that that's a defense to the association levying an assessment. Simply is not, and the allegations are false in any event. Mr. Romanico, as we said, is dealing with most of the rest of the motions, but if you look at the case of Forest Villas versus Camarillo, which is a 1992 case from the Georgia Court of Appeals, the court was very clear, and the court's followed this ever since, that if a member has a beef with the association, they can raise that beef, but it is not a defense to a claim for an assessment that's due. The assessment is independent, and whatever the merits or value of the claim that the member has in arguing with the association over some other point, it's not a defense to an assessment that's been levied and has not been paid. Ms. Neill hasn't challenged the affidavits from the board, that the board acted properly, that it acted to unanimously approve the $5,000 levy against her. All she's left open is that she's exempt from assessments under the City Heights versus Bombara case. If the affidavit that we'll talk about in a minute is stricken, there's no affidavit from Ms. Neill or any other evidence from Ms. Neill contradicting the association's entitlement to the assessment. If the affidavit's not stricken, and I'll deal with that in a minute, the only thing that's in there that relates at all to the assessment is, I think it's, she numbered it paragraph 54, although it comes after 36 on page 16, that she demanded the association file an insurance claim. That's it. Nothing else in the affidavit relates. So even if the affidavit is not stricken, there's still no evidence that Ms. Neill has submitted to contradict the evidence provided on summary judgment to the court. So that leaves us with City Heights versus Bombara, which I think is easily distinguishable. Ms. Neill portrays Bombara as a get-out-of-jail-free card, that if she cites Bombara, she can never be assessed for costs the association incurred. But that's not what Bombara stands for. Bombara was a modification or distinction that was drawn against a case called Pew versus One Buckhead Lube, also cited to the court in the briefs. And let's look at the case of One Buckhead Lube and the case of Bombara and see how they relate to the current case. The origin of the claim for attorney's fees is the first issue. In One Buckhead Lube, the fees arose from the association having incurred expenses unrelated to assessment litigation, having to get a restraining order against the owner and the owner's tenant for stalking the property manager. So they based their entitlement to the attorney's fees assessment on the actions of Mr. Pugh and his tenant. In City Heights, the claim was different. In City Heights, there was no assessment by the association. In fact, the court expressly notes that the claim for attorney's fees was one added by the attorneys after a suit was filed against the association. It didn't predate the litigation. It only was a result of the litigation. The City Heights case determined that that was not a proper source of a claim for a special assessment and denied the association assessments for the claim that the attorneys had added as part of the litigation, as opposed to One Buckhead Lube, where the association had assessed prior to the litigation the cost against the owner. If we look at our case, as Mr. Monaco pointed out, the assessment was levied when there was no litigation pending. The assessment is not one that we added to dissuade Ms. Neill from filing suit. It was an expense that was incurred at her insistence, due solely to her demands that she voiced many, many times, that a claim be filed and that the association incur the expense to investigate the 2012 pension. So that puts our case more in line with One Buckhead Lube than it does with Bombara or City Heights, City Heights versus Bombara. Second, I go back to something I mentioned a moment ago. In One Buckhead Lube, the charges were assessed before the litigation. In City Heights, the charges were added by the attorneys during the litigation. In our case, the costs were incurred and assessed prior to any litigation, just like it was in One Buckhead Lube. These expenses were made necessary by Ms. Neill, by her sole actions, in responding to her threats of suit and challenge to the 2012 actions by the Board of Directors. Again, the original actions were taken on the advice of counsel and with the board authority, and the board had authority to act. One of the cases that's cited in the briefs is Amberfield Homeowners Association versus Young. It's a case I didn't particularly agree with when I represented the homeowner in that case against the association, but the Court of Appeals determined that the corporate authority of the board is that broad. It is broad enough that it would include levying the assessment against, it's broad enough that it would include making a determination on giving a pension to Mr. Miller. Second, Neill demanded an insurance claim be filed and threatened litigation. As I say, having sent a draft of the lawsuit and a draft of briefs, that's where the cost came from. The claim was filed at the direct insistence of Ms. Neill. Costs were incurred for the claim. As again, I refer to page 16 of her affidavit, where she quotes her demand that the association file an insurance claim. Neill was assessed only for the cost of the deductible, not for all the other expenses that had been incurred up to that point. So the costs were, in fact, just related to her actions and were actually assessed by the board before any litigation started. Third, if we look at the nature of the dispute, we've see the nature of the dispute here is more akin to One Buckhead Loop than it is to City Heights versus Bombara. In One Buckhead Loop, the cause of the expense is related to the actions of Mr. Pugh and his tenants. It did not relate to any duty owed by One Buckhead Loop to Mr. Pugh. In City Heights, the issue was different. In that case, Bombara alleged that the association owed a duty to him personally to repair the mold damage in his particular unit. In that case, the Court of Appeals determined that the association had some culpability in the claim, and therefore an award of damages was not proper in the City Heights case, because the association participated. They were involved in whether or not they repaired the mold issue that was owed directly to Mr. Bombara, or Ms. Bombara. In our case, it's clear that Ms. Neill demanded the insurance deductible be incurred and an insurance claim be filed, and Mount Vernon Towers was not under any particular duty directly to Ms. Neill as an individual, and therefore we're closer to One Buckhead Loop than we are to City Heights. The action complained about by Ms. Neill occurred in 2012 before Ms. Neill was even owner, which raises questions of whether she has the ability to challenge it. The action complained of occurred well outside of any statute of limitations that would undo the pension agreement. And again, any duty that was owed was one to the association and not to Ms. Neill individually. Ms. Neill has argued to this court in the briefs and papers that she's filed that she's going to have to follow up on the pension in a derivative claim, that it's not her personal claim. She can't bring that. So there's no duty that was owed to her. She acknowledges there's nothing that she has in an individual claim. So unlike City Heights, where the Bombaras had an individual claim against the association, and that precluded an award of attorney's fees, we're more like One Buckhead Loop, where there was no individual duty owed to Ms. Neill, and the assessment was proper. So that's basically our argument on summary judgment. Ms. Neill caused the association to incur the expense. The board assessed the $5,000 against Ms. Neill under the authority of the Georgia Condominium Act and the declaration. The assessment hasn't been paid. We're entitled to judgment for the assessment. Since we're entitled to judgment for the assessment, we're entitled to judgment for liability on the attorney's fees, and City Heights doesn't apply. Let me now just turn briefly to the motion to strike the affidavit, because that's the only evidence that Ms. Neill has introduced in the case in all of that volume of paper. She introduced the affidavit that supposedly was related to her summary judgment motion or whatever other claims she is making. We filed our motion under 9/11-12F to strike that. Now, a motion to strike an affidavit is clearly disfavored. It's only appropriate in specific cases and under specific facts. So we start off with the proposition that generally the court's not going to strike an affidavit or a pleading unless there are exigent circumstances that require it. Except in paragraphs on page 16 of the affidavit, it doesn't deal with the special assessment. It talks about illegal acts by the board illegal acts by the board doing a pension. It talks about alleged malpractice by Mr. LaMonaco, by myself, by Mr. Nowak, who's had no involvement in the case at all, other than to not return a phone call to Ms. Neill. That's his total involvement in this case. But she's alleging in all of the rest of her affidavit malpractice, fraud, and I think she even at one point put in criminal elder abuse in one of her pleadings. But none of that has anything to do with the summary judgment or anything to do with the special assessment. So first of all, it's just not relevant to the case. Second, affidavit is not from her personal knowledge. She's not competent to testify on all the allegations that she made in the affidavit. She has not provided any basis on which she has personal knowledge of advice that was given to the board of directors. She hasn't provided any evidence where she has personal knowledge of any of the scandalous and libelous claims that she makes in her affidavit. So she doesn't have personal knowledge. The affidavit isn't made on personal knowledge. The only thing that's personal knowledge is that she made a demand for an E&O claim by the association, and that was one paragraph out of 90 plus paragraphs in a 45-page affidavit. That doesn't make the whole affidavit relevant to the case or subject to being left without being stricken. But more importantly, if we look at the case of Chapois versus Ortho Sport and Spine Physicians, Savannah LLC, which was a 2019 case decided by the Georgia Supreme Court, the Supreme Court made clear that an affidavit that is primarily intended to be scandalous and defamatory is subject to being stricken by the trial court if it doesn't serve any other purpose in the case. And I briefed that pretty completely in what I sent to the court, but the affidavit is not entitled to deference against striking when it's scandalous. An affidavit is just, argues just irrelevant. The court gives great deference to, but not to one, according to the Supreme Court, is intended to be scandalous. And it's no question that that's what she intends. There's no relevance to the case. And she even states in her pleadings and in her filings, I think in the affidavit, that she intended it to be scandalous because she wants the jury to read it to see how evil the attorneys are and therefore impugn evil attorneys to the association's position and deny the association any protection in the court. The affidavit misstates a lot of provisions in addition of law. She quotes extensively from the Internal Revenue Code relating to corporations that are nonprofit under the Internal Revenue Code, never acknowledging that the Condominium Association doesn't fall under that code section. They're not a nonprofit code. So she also has included that and many other misstatements of law as part of her affidavit, so she can get that in front of the jury and make arguments that aren't based in fact and aren't based in law. The affidavit, frankly, just simply needs to be stricken.
Your Honor, I can just clarify one thing, Randy's rendition of the timeline, because he just glossed over one thing that I did want to point out. As he said, I believe the insurance claim was initially made in late 2017. I finally got assigned the case. It was, I think, late April, early May of 2018. We initially looked at it, then kind of kept it on hold over the summer, and then it was in the fall of 18 that I really started working on the case after. It's in some of her pleadings, because Ms. Neill did an 8 or 9 week weekly update of very extensive emails, which then it was decided it looks like she's about to sue. We better get to the bottom of this issue, and that's when I really started doing the work.
Okay. First off, do you agree that those, as the issues were articulated earlier, that can be isolated and reviewed today, do you agree with that?
Mostly, Your Honor.
Okay.
Before we proceed, may we approach? This is very brief.
Okay, that's fine.
The reason this case has been so extraordinarily well briefed is because it has taken me hundreds of hours to wade through the fog of the fraud committed by Mr. Lipschitz, and Mr. LaMonaco. I'm a trial lawyer. I practiced in Atlanta for 16 years before I moved to Denver with my husband. This has been an ordeal, to say the least, and I apologize to the court because the court has literally experienced my learning curve as I figured out through the process of briefing the fraud that has been committed against me, the senior citizens of Mount Vernon Towers, and ultimately the court. With respect to the court's authority to address the assessment against me, I've read the statute, I've briefed the statute as well, and I believe that the court has plenary authority. I have filed a motion to amend to add a claim for ultra vires act, which is a breach of contract. If I have not worded it in the proper manner that the court desires me to word it in, I am happy to amend. That being said, to very briefly address the Pew and the City Heights case. In Pew, the board of directors sought a restraining order based on the conduct of a tenant. Whatever the tenant's conduct was, apparently a court found it sufficient to it literally issue a restraining order. The restraining order, we don't know what the underlying basis was, but the court ultimately found that yes, the association can assess attorney's fees for that. City Heights is completely different, has a different holding, which is exactly analogous to this case. The exact holding of City Heights, this is from the Court of Appeals. City Heights' argument that the Bombaris lawsuit was conduct that occasioned common expenses misreads Pew and the declaration. The declaration allows City Heights to recapture costs in the form of a special assessment, resulting from the conduct of less than all the unit owners. So does Mount Vernon Towers. This necessarily means that the conduct of the unit owner against whom the assessment is imposed must be the cause of the commons expense, and that no conduct of the association itself or any other owners also caused the expense. The issue about which I have been complaining has been the pension. It was the board who voted for it, albeit on, this is the first time. I want to take a moment here. Today, in this court today was the first time that Mr. Lipschitz has admitted that he gave the board in 2012 the advice that it had the authority to enter the pension. I asked that question in 2017. This relates to my affidavit. I had spoken with another HOA lawyer and a labor and employment lawyer. Both said the same thing. This looks like an ultra vires act. The pension, this is unheard of. And I wrote to Mr. Lipschitz and I said, I don't know if you were the HOA lawyer, but whoever was the HOA lawyer, this looks like malpractice. His response to me, this is October 11, 2017, so over 2 years ago. Second, nowhere in the letter, he then accused me of defaming him. Nowhere in the letter did I confirm or deny that I had advised the board on any particular issue on the Miller pension in the time period you referenced. What my letter stated was that you thinly veiled the accusation that I had committed malpractice. He goes on, further, until I have direction from the board of directors, I am not going to engage in a debate over the substantive issues. Without direction from the board, it would be unprofessional to do so. You are free to complain as you want about a lack of substantive response, but you will need to await the time when such a substantive response is appropriate. It's been almost 700 days, 26 months, and there's still no substantive response. Your Honor, the assessment itself is simply illegal. The argument is from the defense, essentially, so what? We're the board of directors, we can do whatever we want. While the board of directors does have plenary power, that plenary power is not unlimited. There must be an ability to have judicial review of special assessments. The cases which Mr. Lipschitz cited where the courts have declared, yes, assessments are appropriate, aren't special assessments. And many of them are not special assessments with respect to complaint about a specific issue that the board engaged in, here the pension. They're just inapplicable. They're not analogous to our case. City Heights is, and it controls. I have no further argument on the assessment issue, although I certainly understand that the court has questions. I don't want to miss anything if the court does have questions about the assessment.
You can proceed.
Okay. With respect to the affidavit, it is extraordinarily thorough with respect to the fraud and malpractice committed by particularly Mr. Lipschitz, to some extent Mr. LaMonaco. They are fact-based. I am a lawyer. I am qualified to put law in my affidavit as part of my expertise in the legal field. And it is extraordinarily thorough with respect to the fraud that has been committed by Mr. Lipschitz against the association. I would like to present an exhibit to the court, Your Honor.
Your Honor, can I just approach it because of the way the glare is?
You can. Go to where you can see.
This was from one of your emails. No objection for demonstrative purposes, Your Honor.
And then for demonstrative purposes?
Only for demonstrative purposes, Your Honor. At this time, Your Honor, I would like to give a brief explanation of what happened with respect to this pension and how it relates to why I was assessed.
Very good.
Okay. Mount Vernon Towers is 300 units. It's a condominium association, and it's made of a 55 and over clientele. Most of the senior citizens who live there in their 70s, 80s, 90s, and there are some 100-year-old seniors.
So you're an owner, but not a resident.
I am an owner, not a resident, Your Honor. Thank you for asking. The pension came about as a result of three bad actors who coalesced all in 2012. So what had happened, Mr. Miller, apparently according to information that I have received from others, he was divorced at some time prior to 2012. He worked for a bank during a time period when pensions were very available, commonplace. He was the vice president of something in a bank, pretty high up. It appears he received a pension based on circumstantial evidence, but he got divorced. His wife may have received it. All of this will be borne out if depositions are allowed. We haven't gone through any discovery. At some point, there were conversations by the then board chair, Ralph Marion, who is now deceased. But in 2012, and a couple of years prior to that, there were conversations along the lines of, when are you going to retire? according to the bombshell memo that was disclosed by the association during discovery, the conversation around that started getting more serious in 2012. Now, the email that I received from, that my mother actually received from Doris Davies, who was a board member at the time, the reason that the pension was awarded is because Mr. Miller's retirement was woefully inadequate. Those were the words that she used. What happened is the then CFO of Mount Vernon Towers, which is a nonprofit homeowners association, the then CFO, who had lost his job, he was working for a construction company, the second largest commercial construction company in Atlanta. He had lost his job during the Great Recession. He is acting as an independent contractor and serving as CFO for Mount Vernon Towers. He writes this opinion email or letter, I don't know, to Ralph Marion, who is the board chair, saying, here's why $90,000 per year is the appropriate pension amount. And the way in which he did this is he analogized, this is the second largest commercial construction company, and he analogized the way that the commercial construction company did its pension program, its compensation program, with Mount Vernon Towers, a 300-person nonprofit. Nowhere in the, what I have called the bombshell memo, nowhere is there any discussion of the best interest of Mount Vernon Towers. Now, what's crucially important here is this pension is an unfunded pension. What unfunded means is that during Mr. Miller's tenure of working for Mount Vernon Towers, there were no contributions to the pension. He retires, and then all the future owners, senior citizens on generally a fixed income, the senior citizens after he retires contribute to paying him. This pension was unfunded, undisclosed. Undisclosed meaning no one knew about it. So when the 2012 board voted, as Mr. Lipschitz admitted today, he gave the board authority that they had the power, the authority to vote for it.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I'm not sure I heard that. So what was said?
Sorry.
That's okay.
Mr. Lipschitz said today that he gave the board, the 2012 board, the thumbs up, that he said that the board had authority to enter the contract.
You'll have a chance to respond.
Okay. He did not have specialty in pension agreements. There are two separate issues. Drafting a complex pension agreement would be outside an HOA lawyer's purview, as it would be mine as well. What is in his purview is whether under the Georgia Nonprofit Code and whether under the HOA Act, the board has authority. So we've got three bad actors. Mr. Peterson, who at the time was unemployed from an employment job. He was doing independent contracting in accounting work. Mount Vernon Towers is one of his clients. Tommy Miller, who's woefully inadequate retirement. Tommy Miller, in the bombshell memo, highly recommends Mr. Peterson, Chris Peterson, to get his $200,000 per year job. Mr. Peterson recommends that Mr. Miller get a $90,000 per year pension. It's very clear in the bombshell memo that we've got two corporate officers of a nonprofit helping one another. This is insider dealings. No one was talking about the best interests of Mount Vernon Towers. No one did any sort of, hey, is is $200,000 an appropriate salary? There's no discussion of any of this.
Tell me about your standing to raise this issue.
Bad faith, Your Honor. So my standing with respect to the discussion related to the pension is the bad faith part of the argument. Why was I assessed? That's why I was assessed. I got too close to Randy Lipschitz's malpractice. Your Honor, I was extraordinarily vocal with respect to we need an independent lawyer to look at the pension issue. Extraordinarily vocal. I was assessed because if anybody looks at this, he handpicked Jason LaMonaco. I have the email that he sent to the insurance company, and I had it here, in which he requests that Jason LaMonaco be appointed. When they did, this is in their briefing, it's in the letter that was signed by the current board chair. When they did the analysis that is the foundation of why I was assessed, because remember, I'm saying it's illegal, right? A year ago today, literally a year ago today, Randy Lipschitz stood up in the Condominium Association annual meeting, and he says, 3-1, meaning 3-1. I would later find out in July of this year, through a letter that the board chair signed, that the analysis of the pension, the reason why the board had authority to sign the pension, is because Mr. Lipschitz and Mr. LaMonaco just completely avoided the entire issue of whether the pension is either reasonable compensation or a distribution. Distribution in the context of this pension is anything that's not reasonable compensation. They just ignored the outcome determinative issue. And then they assessed me. If any other lawyer that wasn't hand-selected by Mr. Lipschitz had looked at this, they would have looked at the Georgia Nonprofit Code. The Nonprofit Code provides that a nonprofit can award reasonable compensation, but it may not give a distribution. So the question is, what's reasonable compensation and what's a distribution? It's an extraordinarily important question because it's the only question that matters. I got assessed because I was saying Randy Lipschitz committed malpractice. He's the one that looks like approved this. We need a second opinion. Excuse me. These are the numbers. If the pension is $90,000, that's almost $1.7 million. That is $6,000 per senior citizen owner. There's been about, actually now, 5.5 years, but if it is $90,000, that is $450,000 of malpractice exposure. I have briefed, as part of my affidavit and as part of the legal briefings, the law that is, quite frankly, child's play. When you follow the logic of all the law, all the way down, everything indicates this is a completely illegal pension. I was assessed $5,000 for Jason LaMonaco to give Randy Lipschitz a rubber stamp that the board had authority when they avoided the entire issue of whether it is reasonable compensation or a distribution. Distribution is anything that's not reasonable compensation. The federal law that is cited in my affidavit, I provided to them in February of this year. anyone who is looking at the federal law that I provided would have common sense seen the similarities between federal law and Georgia state law. Let me explain. Most homeowners associations file taxes as a nonprofit. The federal code for tax code for nonprofits, any nonprofit has to show that in order to enter into a catch-up agreement, which is this type of pension is also known as a catch-up agreement, that the person to whom it is issued was underpaid during the tenure. You're a nonprofit. You can't just give away money. Compensation must be reasonable. So the federal tax code says if you want to award a pension or a catch-up agreement, you have to show us objectively through a third-party credible company that actually does a compensation study about whether or not someone has been legitimately underpaid during their tenure. In order, now, Mount Vernon Towers does not file its taxes as a nonprofit. They are disqualified as a result of the fact that there is a dining room and a personal care facility. There's too much income. The federal code uses the words reasonable compensation, private inurement. Those are the two words. Private inurement is anything that's not reasonable compensation, a personal benefit, private inurement. The Georgia nonprofit code, which Mount Vernon Towers is a Georgia nonprofit, says reasonable compensation distribution. The nonprofit code doesn't give an exact definition of a distribution, but it's anything that's not reasonable compensation in context of this pension. What's extraordinarily important and what's also very interesting, I figured out, again, and I apologize, the court has gone through the learning process with me. I figured out in late June, every homeowners association always has the ability to file as a for-profit corporation. You check a box, it's a choice. Some, like Mount Vernon Towers, are automatically disqualified, but every association has the ability. When the Congress, in the recent tax code changes, changed the corporate rates to 21%, they forgot to, inadvertent I'm sure, but they forgot to change the nonprofit rate, which is still 30%. If any HOA has good counsel, and you're choosing between filing for nonprofit at a 30% tax rate, or filing, checking the box and filing for a for-profit at 21%, you're gonna file for 21%. I mean, it's simple math. The idea that the whole reason that Mount Vernon Towers can literally do whatever it wants, that only the board is entitled to determine reasonable compensation with zero judicial review, is because the lawyers thought that they didn't have to, right? They didn't think through the consequences. Clearly, the declarations that Mount Vernon Towers talk about, what every condominium association talks about, common areas, restoration, maintenance. That's it, right? That's the purpose of the condominium association, to take care of the common elements. Randy Lipschitz had an ethical obligation as a lawyer to look at the best interests of his client, Mount Vernon Towers. He did in 2012. He doesn't represent Chris Peterson or Tommy Miller. He represents the association.
Is there anything in the covenants that required a vote of the residents?
Good question. No, not specifically. The covenants talk about, or I think it's the bylaws, pardon me, talk about $50,000 as being the limit. that the board can vote for.
For an expenditure?
For an expenditure, but the way that the bylaw is written, it really references expenditures for capital expenses.
Have the residents been paying for the pension since 2012 then?
Yes.
And has anyone else?
Pardon me. 2015. He retired in 2014 or 2015. I can't remember.
Have any residents attempted to file suit?
No. We are through the course of this, when I figured out the extraordinarily thorough affidavit that I've written that point blank spells out exactly what Mr. Lipschitz did and how he responded to things. I mean, it's very detailed. This is the bad faith, and this is a lot of what's in point number two, the motion to disqualify. But the way in which the bylaws are written, it's open to interpretation, and certainly a conservative interpretation of the bylaws themselves would also make this pension invalid. That is not really, again, the law related to the pension is not directly related to this lawsuit. However, it's the bad faith element. I was assessed because Randy Lipschitz didn't want anybody looking at what he had done. The board has voted year after year after year to keep the pension undisclosed. I mean, the board has received a letter for 2 years in a row now from their independent accountants that the independent accountants who do the spot check of the books have told them it violates the accounting procedures in the United States of America not to accrue the pension.
So do I have to find that the $5,000 in question was lodged against you to have a chilling effect on looking into the pension? Do I have to find that for you to have standing to even bring this up?
Thank you for asking the question. I want to think about my response.
Okay.
I don't know the answer to that question without researching it.
Okay.
I will say that logically, my bad faith claim doesn't necessarily rest upon that finding.
Okay.
I can argue the bad faith without the court, I think, as long as there is they had an election, the community had an election last night, and there were three new board members.
Okay.
The likelihood, frankly, of my bad faith claim seeing the light of day in front of a Fulton County jury is very small. If the lawyers are struck, and that is because anybody who looks at this is going to look at the same thing. A, there was malpractice in the assessment. It's illogical to argue that, well, we got lucky and we assessed her before she filed a lawsuit. Georgia does not allow the transfer of legal fees pre-suit. A court may award legal fees, and there are obviously statutes, but I'm going to sue you. Well, I'm going to assess you $5,000. They can't do it. They simply cannot do it. I know there's a desire to do it, and the desire is that the court is never going to review it, and I just totally reject that premise. Otherwise, associations can do literally whatever they want to homeowners, whether it's legal or not.
How many members are on the board?
Five. So we have a new controlling majority.
Okay.
My bad faith claim, as long as the court finds there's sufficient evidence of bad faith, I don't think that the court has to make a specific finding that there was bad faith, only that there is a question of fact. Now, again, I don't think my case is going to go to a jury trial because I think there might be an opportunity to settle. That being aside, Does that answer the question? I have not researched your specific question.
Oh, that's fine.
Okay. that's all I have at this time, unless the board has further questions.
I don't. Thank you. Well, the board respond in whatever order is most logical.
Your Honor, if I can respond just briefly just on the false statements Ms. Neill made about me. I did not tell the court that I advised the board in 2012. I think Your Honor probably heard correctly when I said McKenna Long Aldridge advised him in 2012. In 2017, I was asked to look at whether I thought the board had authority to act in 2012, which was the first time it had been brought to me with a question to look at. So all of the plethora of bad charges that she alleges that I did because I misadvised the board in 2012 are just flat out false. She's been told by me that I didn't have anything to do with it in 2012. She's been told by the board that I didn't have anything to do with it in 2012. She's filed a copy of a letter the board sent to the community saying I had nothing to do with it in 2012. She's been told by McKenna Long Aldridge, now Denton's, that I wasn't involved, that they were the ones that gave the board advice. She makes up things, and based upon made up facts, she makes all sorts of assertions. So I just wanted to correct the record and go back to what I stated before. In 2017, after the fact, I was asked to look to see whether I thought the board had authority to act. The Amberfield case was pending, so I knew that was an issue, as whether the board had authority to act in that fashion. I ended up losing the Amberfield case against an association. The association board was told they have broad authority.
Will you remind me of the facts of that case?
In Amberfield?
Uh-huh.
Oh, yes, Your Honor. In Amberfield, there was an adjacent swim club that wasn't owned by the association, that wasn't part of the association, that some of the members, that all the members had the right to voluntarily join. And the board of directors decided that they wanted to pass a change to the documents that made every member a mandatory member of the swim club that they didn't own and make that an assessment against each owner every year. Some of the owners objected, thought that was beyond the authority of the board. I challenged it on behalf of the owners. And the Court of Appeals said, no, the board can do whatever the heck it wants to. Excuse the language, but that's basically what it said. But that's the Amberfield case.
Okay.
I would probably agree with one of the statements Ms. Neill made that the decision I didn't think was a particularly good one, but it's the decision we got from the Court of Appeals, so we live with that decision. I simply did not have an obligation to advise the board on something I wasn't asked to participate in 2012. I'm not sure how I'm supposed to be prescient and know that the board was going to make a decision, final decision on a pension, but that's apparently what Ms. Neill has argued. Therefore, I committed malpractice.
What was the purpose of the $5,000 assessment?
The $5,000 assessment was the deductible that had to be paid to Noack Howard for the insurance claim that Ms. Neill demanded that the association file. They filed the claim, they eventually incurred the deductible. It was determined by the board determined that by looking at what they've been told by McKenna Long Aldridge, looking at my informal opinion that I offered in 2017, and looking at the formal opinion offered by Noack Howard, that the 2012 board had authority, there was no basis for having to incur that expense in the board's opinion. The board made a business decision that $5,000 was incurred solely at the cause of Ms. Neill, not because of anything the 2012 board had done improperly, and they levied the assessment. They made a business decision, just like the board in Amberfield made a business decision to make everybody be a member of a private club that wasn't part of the association.
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to move quickly, just handing up a case if I may approach.
Yes, we
can. It's not very remarkable, it's just the standard ruling that 13611 bad faith claim, which is all that is before the court, and a proposed amendment is just adding to that. her 13-6 amendment bad faith payment is a 13-6-11 bad faith. That does not stand alone. That is a way, a vehicle to possibly get attorney's fees if she were to prevail. It is not its own claim. And it does, it's not, can't be a basis to expand discovery, you know, exponentially. And particularly when, and it's not a reason to bring the pension into this case. This case is not about the propriety, impropriety, validity, invalidity, authority to do the pension. This case was originally about, give me a copy, well, court declare that I'm entitled to a copy of it. Those claims are gone. The only claims remaining is court declare that, and Ms. Neill's claims, court declare that the $5,000 special assessment is invalid. Mm-hmm. That's it. The pension is irrelevant to whether the $5,000 special assessment is invalid or not. You heard the arguments, you heard the counter arguments, is it valid or not? And the court will decide that in the context of the counterclaims. If the court lacks subject matter jurisdiction, as I've argued, to declare in a DJ context, declaratory judgment context, that the $5,000 assessment is valid or not, then there is no bad faith claim because it goes away along with that cause of action.
If the plaintiff doesn't have standing to challenge the pension issue, what would have been the right mechanism to challenge the pension issue?
Derivative action, and she filed a notice in this claim, notice of intent to file a derivative proceeding. She has an attorney, Cyrus Malkabadi, who's observing the proceedings and has been put on the pleadings in this, but we all discussed it. He's not representing her in this case. He's on this so we can stay abreast of it because he is the attorney she has retained for the derivative proceedings.
For that action?
Yeah, she sent the 90-day notice and all that stuff.
Where's that action?
It has not been filed.
Okay.
As far as I know,
okay.
It hasn't been filed.
Okay.
So this is quite the 13611 bad faith claim, which is not its own claim. So I'm not really sure why we're even arguing this. There's no motion for pending that would trigger the 13611. 13611 only becomes an issue if she wins her substantive claims, which maybe Your Honor will let them go. I've argued that they should be dismissed. But that's it. They still, first they have to proceed, and then she has to win. This is all utterly irrelevant today. And I just remind the court, as when you're going through all of these papers, just please keep in mind, there is not a single document authenticated anywhere. in just reams of documents attached to briefs and submitted to the court. And then long renditions of where Ms. Neill makes her arguments, then quotes maybe from an email, usually from Randy, then hypothesizes what Randy should have said, puts it in quotes, and then says, this is why it's malpractice, this is why you've committed fraud. And it's just again and again and again. There is a visceral hatred, and it is so clear between that Ms. Neill hates this man. And I have absolutely no idea why. All I know is that since I've come into this case, and I really didn't really get involved until last fall, I'm now part of the brunt. My poor partner, George Nowak, who simply didn't return a call because I said, you don't need to call her back, I'll deal with this. We're representing the association. His name is brought into everything. Constant malpractice, fraud. And I say, what fraud was perpetrated upon her? She knows everything. Part of fraud is that she's been deceived. But clearly, she knows everything. How could there possibly be fraud? If there was malpractice, malpractice is not a basis for bad faith. Bad faith is a basis for bad faith. Malpractice is a negligence issue. Did we give a bad opinion? Should we have known better? Maybe. I doubt it. But again, it's not an issue. But here's, again, no substantive response. I've never gotten a substantive response to the pension issue. Well, she's not my client. She's not Randy's client. I was asked to give an opinion about the pension, and my firm gave an opinion to my client about the pension. She's not entitled to that. So no substantive response. It's not her. She hasn't gotten standing at this point. If there's a derivative proceeding filed, it'll be dealt with in that case.
whether the pension was advisable, ill-advisable, authorized, not authorized, valid, invalid, is not an issue in this case. She's desperately trying to make it an issue, but to the extent she could even bring it in, she has to win the special assessment issue first, then maybe get attorney's fees based on bad faith. And I don't know that the pension is even relevant to that. Okay. Just a couple of false statements. Chris Peterson was not an officer. Chris Peterson was an employee or an independent contractor of the association. When she said two officers colluding about who should get a pension and who should get whose job. As she said, Chris Peterson was an independent contractor. Tommy Miller was an employee of the association. He was the chief executive officer in that sense, but he wasn't an officer under the bylaws. He wasn't the president, vice president, secretary, or treasurer of the association on that. And he hasn't been an employee, he hasn't been an employee of the association since 2014 when he retired. I'm only addressing it because I just don't want to leave it lingering. Ms. Neill has hammered on this distribution. We don't consider it distribution. It was a distribution, this pension, because it's unreasonable compensation. That only applies if the person is an officer, director, or member of the association. It does not apply to employees. It's irrelevant. Under distribution, it talks about distribution is a distribution when money is given to an officer, director, or member. He's employee of the association. See, not giving her a substantive, maybe that's a substantive response. I don't know what she wants, but the issue is, it's not an issue. The pension, this court is not deciding under any circumstances. I don't even have to argue it. It's not being asked to decide the propriety of the pension, but yet it's being dragged in this roundabout way under this supposed bad faith issue. The pension is not an issue in this case. She's going to sue on it, and it's going to get hashed out, but let's not get distracted about it in this case. So the court, it's just not an issue for this case. Courts have the power to review the pension in the proper proceeding. That's not here. It will be brought, and we know it's going to be brought. And finally, it just doesn't seem to make sense that over a period, after I even got into this case, over a period of, I think it was 9 weeks, each email had week 8, week 9, whatever it was, going over all the alleged fraud of Randy and all the things, and demanding that the court, that the association get a second opinion from another lawyer, and then one comes in and gives the association a second opinion, not satisfied with it. So I don't know what will satisfy the plaintiff, but at this point, the pension is not an issue in this case. That's why we're not arguing the pension. It's standing and the special assessment, or subject matter jurisdiction and special assessment. Thank you.
Your Honor, the first thing I want to address is the word hate. It's the wrong word. It is not that I hate Mr. Lipschitz, and it's not that I hate Mr. LaMonaco. The correct word is lack of respect. I brought up malpractice of the attorney who said that the board had authority in 2017 after the 2017 board chair, Doris Davies, who was also on the 2012 board, wrote my mom an email that said that the HOA attorney had vetted the pension. That is the point at which I brought up malpractice. I requested a copy of it. I said, here, I've spoken with two other lawyers. Everybody agrees this looks really bad. If it smells bad, as we know, what we're taught in law school. If something smells bad, the law almost always provides a remedy. It smelled bad. My mother is 83 years old. She is an owner resident. I had gotten to know a lot of her friends. They're wonderful people. And they had, no one had any idea about this pension. These owners are on a fixed income. I heard stories of owners cutting pills to make ends meet. That's why I got involved. Hate is not the right word. I lost respect for Randy Lipschitz when he stood up at the December 2017 meeting and I had requested disclosure of the amount of the pension. And he said that the board could not disclose the amount of the pension because Tommy Miller had a U.S. constitutional right to privacy and a Georgia constitutional right to privacy in the amount of the pension. I'm a lawyer. I've been educated in law school. I practice law. There is no such right. I knew it instinctively. I researched it. There is absolutely no such right. I asked him to provide any legal authority that he couldn't disclose based on this newly discovered right that he made up. And he basically told me the association doesn't pay me to do research.
Okay, we haven't heard any of your motions yet, so if you'll move forward towards your motions.
Thank you, Your Honor. With respect to my motion to, I think, quite honestly, a lot of this comes down to the motion to disqualify counsel. There is ample evidence that the whole reason that I was assessed and the reason why the NOAC firm totally avoided giving a valid legal opinion to the board with respect to this pension, which is why I was assessed. I was assessed because they got a second opinion. The second opinion was that the board had authority. I was assessed so that no one else would look at the pension issue and that the wool could be pulled over owner's eyes, not just mine, but every other owner with respect to this pension that Randy Lipschitz had been saying again and again was valid. In the letter, when Mr. LaMonaco talks about substance, of that I don't have a right to ask for a substantive opinion with respect to the legality of the pension. Well, I'm an owner, of course I do. I have a right to ask the association, why is this legal? So does every other owner. Everyone has a right to ask a question. I threatened a lawsuit for 5 days in late April last year. It was for disclosure of the pension agreement because I thought with disclosure of the pension agreement, I'd be able to figure out what the issues were. I withdrew it out of respect for my mother because she did not want to be the pariah in the community, and I respect and love my mother. I was assessed because of that. With respect to two officers, I don't understand what they're talking about, that both Mr. Miller was not an officer. He was the CEO of Mount Vernon Towers at the time the pension was awarded. The bombshell memo lists Mr. Peterson as CFO. I'm not quite understanding where they're coming from because this was, in fact, two officers of a corporation. They may have been employees as well, but these were officers of the corporation. I think I have argued the bad faith, and really, if the court has any questions about whether the association has ratified the actions of its lawyers, I want to address those. I've briefed it. I've included a copy of the letter that they sent in July, basically, what I have labeled the Scorch the Earth letter.
It's on the record.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They resent it in November, so there's no, when they sent out the December meeting packet, they resent the same letter, so there's no question there's ratification. I think that I have covered the bad faith. I think that I have covered the basis for striking counsel. The fundamental basis for striking counsel is they are witnesses in my bad faith claim. It works to the benefit of the association in the reality, if I take their depositions, any lawyer that looks at this that is a newly retained lawyer is likely to see what I see, that there was clearly malpractice in the assessment. There looks to be very strong malpractice and fraud in the pension discussion. They don't want to talk about the pension, which is the foundation of why I was assessed in the first place, because they know now that they're totally wrong on it. They knew it then, they just didn't want to admit it. I don't think that there is anything else with respect to those issues. The only issues left are the motion to compel and the motion for temporary restraining order. The temporary restraining order I withdraw. The board has changed, and I don't think that this will be necessary, as there will be new board members in whom I have more confidence. I'll leave it at that. With respect to the motion to compel the pension contract, I need it for the bad faith claim. It is the final piece of the puzzle. I don't know where in this spectrum. There is enough evidence that the malpractice is both explicit and implicit. The board implicitly relied on Randy Lipschitz that the board had authority over the contract. There's enough evidence there that they at least implicitly, if not explicitly, relied on his advice in 2012. I need the contract because I want to know the amount. It goes to why all of this happened, why two law firms failed to do the actual work of figuring out reasonable compensation versus distribution. The likelihood is high that any new lawyer would waive attorney-client privilege simply because our interests are exactly the same. The association has malpractice and fraud claims against their lawyers. That's also my bad faith claim, and not malpractice and fraud, but the actions that they have taken. Does the court have any questions?
No.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I just want to clarify that the TRO interlocutory injunction motion's withdrawn. Okay. So, with
that acknowledged for the record? So the TRO?
Oh, sorry. Yes.
Okay.
the basis and the sole basis in Ms. Neill's motion to disqualify counsel is that Mr. Lipschitz and I and Mr. Nowak, my partner, are potential witnesses in the case. But that's not a basis to disqualify counsel. Rule 3.7, which deals with this, I'm citing from a well-known case on this, Clover versus Richelieu, and it's in my brief. Rule 3.7a of the Rules of Professional Conduct of the State Bar of Georgia provides that, quote, a lawyer shall not act as advocate at trial in which the lawyer is likely to be a necessary witness, except where testimony relates to an uncontested issue, testimony relates to the nature and value of legal services, or disqualification of the lawyer would work substantial hardship to the client. The party moving disqualification has the burden, this is going on the case, has the burden of showing that the lawyer is likely to be a necessary witness by demonstrating the lawyer's testimony is relevant to disputed material questions of fact, and there is no other evidence available to prove those facts. At the time, I didn't include a quote from the section, but I actually was dealing with a disqualification issue in another case of mine, and I did a little further research. The next sentence in 3.7 specifically says the rule of imputed disqualification does not apply. So, in other words, she wants Nowak Howard, out, I'm assuming, and she wants Lipschitz Greenblatt out of the case. But there's another lawyer in the firm that can, you know, if I have to testify, which I don't think this court is going to make me do, any other lawyer in my firm can just still be handling the case while I testify. There's no imputed disqualification. And I just lost my train of thought. It's trial only. You don't get disqualified now because I might be at trial. You get disqualified if it's valid at the time of trial. We can litigate this case all the way through, even if Your Honor thinks, you know what, I think she's correct. We go all the way through, and then on the day of trial, we can't be the advocates at trial. Why? The purpose of the rule, and the sole purpose of the rule in the comments, in 3.7 and in the case law, is so that there isn't this confusion for the jury of someone acting as witness and advocate at the same time, because that gets weird as far as the jury is concerned. So we could still sit there, and I could have one of my associates or partners be handling the case, as could Mr. Lipschitz, but that's only at trial. And if it's a bench trial, the court can decide that that's not weird. It's only for the jury. So I don't see a basis for disqualification. If the court allows this case to go further, which I hope it does not, the issue can be dealt with at the relevant time. But you can see from the list of questions, and there's several pages of this list of questions that Ms. Neill has asked Randy and I to respond to, some of which are just legal issues, but others which is, you know, why, you know, why did Mr. Nowak not reply to the, you know, to the telephone call? That's just irrelevant. You know, why did I not look at allegedly, and this is her opinion, why did I not look at the distribution issue when I issued my opinion? It's none of her business. She's a litigant. She doesn't get to know my legal strategy, you know, in this case. So there's all sorts of things which she thinks are factual issues are just her one supposing facts that don't exist, that she's just kind of invented in her mind because it goes to a narrative that she has adopted. So there's really no basis for disqualification whatsoever as far as I can see, and I would ask that the court deny it. Now, I just want to make sure I'm on. Okay. Disclosure of the Miller pension contract. This case began one of the claims at the beginning of this case was declaratory judgment, not actual give it over, but court declared that they're supposed to give me this. That's been withdrawn and confirmed in our emails back and forth and then in the briefs. Ms. Neill said, yes, that's withdrawn. It's just a discovery issue at this point. How does that pension contract, of which Mr. Miller, who's not a party in this case, clearly has a privacy interest in? I have no idea what transpired between Randy and Devon, whether the constitutional rights were brought in or not. I have no idea. But there's clearly a privacy interest in Mr. Miller. There is clearly an interest in the association in protecting the privacy interests of current and former employees, people who could be getting a pension at a different time, and even just generally speaking with vendors. It's, you know, under the corporate code, you can get all, you know, certain amounts of information. Contracts is actually not one of them, and I briefed that initially when it was still kind of an issue in the case. You don't get, a member is not entitled to the roofing contract, landscaping contract, the pool contract. That can necessarily, because they don't fall into what's considered accounting records. And a reason behind that, and it's just a good practical reason, the interest of the corporation is, it might be harder to deal with vendors if I start publishing, you know, all their pricings and their contracts and their competitors start copying it. And that, you know, that we're acting in the marketplace. And that's one of the reasons why we don't, you know, people are not automatically entitled to contracts and things like that, because we're all operating in the marketplace and our vendors may not want those contracts disclosed for a legitimate reason. And I'm analogizing here, but we have a little further privacy interest here. This is his actual compensation. She has no problem that we keep everyone's salary. Aggregate salary is one thing, we publish that. But to tell everyone, should everyone in Mount Vernon Towers know everyone's salary? I think we all agree that no, that's something that should not be, and I think pension is even more of a privacy interest. And Mr. Miller, at one point, there was a motion to bring him into the case that was since been withdrawn. But that got his counsel contacting me, and just want to let it be known, if the court does at some point order that the contract be turned over, I would just ask that, you know, that be either given a sufficient deadline to turn it over, because Mr. Miller will be filing a lawsuit to enjoin that independent. He's not part of this case. It was going to be brought in, and would have brought it in the context of this case that was withdrawn. So if it does happen, I've been informed that they will do it. They'll be going under the ERISA statute. And I don't know a whole lot about ERISA. I brought a little bit on it. I am not going to argue ERISA to the court right now, but I will just hand up some things at the end if the court just wants to look through it. The basic argument being ERISA talks about a certain amount of information that can't be disclosed, or that can only be disclosed to the extent that the same type of information is able to be disclosed under the Social Security Act. That makes this look child's play, Social Security Act. And from what I can tell, and I'm just basing it on what counsel is saying for Mr. Miller, is that the Social Security Act talks about, you know, state and federal tax reporting, but, you know, for the same reason, there's this, nothing can be disclosed for Social Security benefits. It's basically the same issue about pension benefits. I don't know the answer to that question, but they will file presumably in federal court, because what is clear from the statutes that I do have is that there is federal preemption on pension type issues. So I would basically just close by saying there is the amount of the pension, whether it was the amount that was in the memo that's been referred to, less, more, is irrelevant to the bad faith claim. The fact that there was a pension, she was looking into it, and she thinks, and if she can prove that she was assessed by the association, either on advice of counsel, against advice of counsel, encouragement of counsel, whatever, because she was asking about the pension, the amount of the pension is irrelevant. It's just the fact that if she can prove that this was, we don't want you looking behind the curtain, we're going to assess you. That's all she has to prove. It doesn't matter what's behind the curtain. The issue is, because she asked to look behind the curtain, we assessed her. That's all she would need. That's what she would need to prove. What's behind the curtain is irrelevant, whether we legitimately had to hide something or we hide something for an illegitimate reason, or whatever it is. What's behind the curtain is not the point. If she can show that there was some bad faith, oh, how dare you ask, we're going to assess you, that's all she needs. She doesn't need the amount of the pension, but there is no bad faith here. There was a legitimate, has been set forth, you know, there is authority to do this. Ms. Lipschitz is arguing it. The amount has been set forth. But I think most importantly, she asked, get a second opinion. That second opinion came with a $5,000 deductible. It was assessed to her. The association has the authority to do that. She has to pay it. The association doesn't have the authority to do it. She doesn't have to pay it. And Mr. Lipschitz will lose. But regardless, it's not an issue for declaratory judgment. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Very briefly, Your Honor. Very briefly. The association, the assessment itself, I just want to make abundantly clear. When I said the association needs to get a second opinion, I did not anticipate, or should I be expected to anticipate, that they would file an insurance claim that I was threatening a lawsuit. I wasn't. I had only threatened a lawsuit for 5 days and then I withdrew it. There was no threat of litigation. Clearly, I was saying get a second opinion because it smells to high heaven, something's wrong. As it turns out, I was completely right, although it took hundreds of hours to figure it all out because of the fog. These guys won't disclose anything. Through the course of the litigation, I figured it out, and it's well briefed. With respect to the ERISA, I have looked at a lot of the ERISA laws, and I see nothing that would prevent disclosure. If the court is inclined, I would respectfully request that the disclosure is ordered, and of course, I'm amenable to a deadline, and if Miller would like to file in federal court and pay someone, that is just fine. The truth is, this is all part of the, we don't want anyone to know, because if somebody knows what the amount is and figures out it's a distribution, it's totally illegal. And based on the $90,000 per year recommendation, it appears completely illegal. And he does not want his money taken away. So this is, understandably from his position, a very important issue. He doesn't want anyone to know. Thank you, Your Honor.
Anything further? All right, the court is going to take all of these issues under advisement. I want to thank counsel for both sides for their briefs, their patience, outlining the case for the court. I am going to take time to review the briefs. I don't need any additional briefs unless Ms. Schuster reaches out to you for more information.
And is it fair to say that the 915-14 motions are not being pursued at this point?
I'm sorry, Your Honor. I got up too fast.
Okay.
The attorney's fees, sorry.
Your Honor, I think that the attorney's fees issues, I mean, I am absolutely asserting a motion for attorney's fees, but I think it might be relevant to take up at a future oral argument simply because the court's orders with respect to other issues are relevant. We can argue it now. I'm not against arguing.
If it becomes relevant, we can argue it at that point.
Thank you.
It's been briefed.
Yeah, that's right. It's been briefed, haven't we?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you.
Just an inquiry of the court, do you want us to submit proposed orders?
Sure. Both sides can present proposed orders.
A date after January 1st, perhaps?
Yeah, do you think that, is it feasible to present proposed orders by January 10th?
As I'm practicing in two states, Your Honor, I have a lot of deadlines in the first of the year. If we may have until the 15th, if that doesn't fall on the weekend,
yes.
Or whatever.
Is the 15th fine for defense counsel?
15th is a Wednesday. Just make it the 14th because I'm flying out of town on the 15th.
That's fine.
That's a good one.
Proposed orders will be submitted to Ms. Schuster by the 14th of January.
Great.
And if you don't have her card, she can present that by her.
Thank you.
Thank you. And to the members of the audience, thank you for your patience and waiting your turn today. We had a very lengthy docket, and I'm glad you stayed with us so you could see the process. So everyone have a good day.
Thank you, Robert.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Please.
Comments that the court would like to announce today or maybe part of the proposed orders. I'm asking for guidance.
Okay, well, Rule 22 actually provides the guidance.
Hang on. It would just leave it up to Your Honor to impose the restrictions.
Yes.
So it's basically free use unless you impose the restrictions.
That's right.
On that.
Okay. And of course, my request is free use. I certainly understand that the court has other ideas, and I respect those.
Yeah.
Okay, I think, I'm going to leave the ruling with it. It can be used as allowed by law. And if either side has an issue with use, contact court. Thank you, Roland.
Your Honor? Your Honor? I just wanted to thank the court for allowing me to be here today.
Oh, you're welcome. You're very unobtrusive.
Thank you.
Unobtrusive.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
I know. Better than
Yeah, no kidding.